Hello, welcome to Tight Lines. One of the great about turns in angling perception is that fish such as tench, bream and carp are summer species. For anglers of my generation, that's what Mr. Crabtree taught us. How different today's reality when carp are not only viable winter targets, but some anglers consider it prime time. I'm not sure whether Mark Bartlett sees things quite that way, but he is a committed 12-month-of-the-year carp angler, and we have the proof. We'll be out on the bank with him at Oxfordshire's Linear Fisheries, where he shows us his winter approach and proves its effectiveness with a few brazen-nosed beauties. You can see a stunner of a 4-pound, 12-ounce perch caught by specimen hunter Julian Chidgey on a session with Andy Ford at Clovelly Lakes in Devon and learn his killer tactics. I'll have my weekly supply of information and tips in Fishery Focus, my take on what species to target and the best baits and tactics to use on all types of UK waters. And we'll also be seeing the cream of the crop as far as our young anglers are concerned. January's lucky winners of our monthly photo competition will be coming up a bit later too. Well, it's good to see you, mate. Is it your prime time for carp fishing? Is it the time you really like to go?
There's always a good time, Keith, to go fishing. you know, you love being out on the bank. It's something you always want to do. So, yeah, I mean, in the winter as well, the lakes are really quiet, so you can, if you can find the fish, which is the key, then, you know, whether it be 20 degrees or minus 10, you'll get a bite or two.
You've been finding a few. I mean, we have got some evidence coming up a bit later on, but you can stay down there. But there's, that's one you caught, how long ago was that?
That was only a few weeks ago in the middle of January. I caught that from Orchid Lakes, which is a...
Oh, orchid are lovely. Yeah, and an orchid can be a right devil. It's, I mean, sometimes when you'd expect it to be good, it can be as tough as old boots, can't it? But when they're on, when they start having a chew...
Yeah, I mean, like, I went there, struggled once, went back and caught a few, worked it all out, and, yeah, £33, that one.
£33.
So, yeah.
And they're lovely old mirrors there as well. I've been to Orchid a few times. I like marsh a lot. It's a lovely fishery, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that fish is probably, you know, got to be 20 years old, yeah. So it'd be, you know, real pleasure to catch it.
Yeah, it is a pleasure as well. Now, as I mentioned right at the start, there are many commonly held beliefs amongst anglers that often just don't stand up to the test. Last week, we spent a day with Mark at one of the country's premier carp lakes, Brazenose 1 at Linear Fisheries, where he set out to dispel one of those myths himself.
Well, winter fishing is normally associated with hardly any feed at all, just your hook bait in some cases. But we're here, we're on the bank, and we're going against the grain, and hopefully I'm going to show you that a lot of bait can sometimes equal better rewards in the cold, especially in big gravel pits like what we're fishing. We're fishing a 30-acre gravel pit that's 14 foot deep. So if you've just got your hook bait in there, the chances of fish are finding them are pretty remote. So by using a lot of bait as your key attractor, rather than emphasis on your hook bait, which what a lot of people think in the winter, can actually be the difference. And the baits that I do use, there's only a couple of them, but it's for a specific reason. The first one is maggots. Carp absolutely adore these things, whether it be summer, winter, wherever. If you've got some maggots, you're going to catch some carp, especially if you've got a decent quantity of them. And then the next one is just some sweet corn and some boilies. Now, I've soaked the boilies in with the sweet corn. This makes the boilies go real nice and soft. In this deep water, the sweet corn, that's your visual aid, and that will draw carp in, because a lot of the time the carp are sat up in the water, a bit like in a garden pond, where they're just sort of sat there not doing a lot, really. If you've got some bright yellow sweet corn on the bottom of the lake, that will pull the fish down and onto the deck and, you know, get you a couple of bites. And all of this food is really digestible for the carp. It's nice and soft, so when they're feeding, it's almost like it's not too much effort for the fish to eat, and they can almost sort of drink the food. And that's why I just make the boilies nice and soft in the sweet corn juice as well before I spot them out. That's the bait that I'm using, and I'm going to show you exactly how we apply it and what rigs we put over the top. Mix it all up so it goes out nice and evenly. And it gives me the perfect spot mix to start my session off. I'll grab my rod. I'm going to put some of these out now. I've got my little spot all clipped up with the spod rod. That's clipped up to the same distance as my fishing rods. you saw me put my bait out into the lake. The next step is basically just to put our hooks and our hook baits over the top. So this is one of the rigs that I'm going to be using. It's just a simple leg clip setup and just a little bright pop-up. Now, this pop-up's completely different to any of the feed that I've put into the lake. It's a bright orange. Sometimes I use a bright pink. Now, the reason for this is because obviously all my free offerings are on the bottom, and I just want something just to stand out to tell the carp, hey, I'm over here, come and pick me up. So by fishing something really blatant, sometimes, especially with like young, naive fish, you know, they're like kids in a sweet shop. They'll be straight on this, no problem. And that just makes it stand out ever so much compared to everything else. But the other rig I do use is just a grain of artificial corn and a Zigger liner sleeve that I've cut the band off the back and used it as a silicone sleeve, as you would either a piece of shrink tubing or just a bit of sleeving over your hook. Obviously it's red, and that's just to imitate a maggot lying on the bottom. So that should, to a carp, look like a grain of sweet corn and a maggot led next to each other over the top of the sweet corn and the maggots that I've been putting out. Just something that blends in. It's a little bit more subtle than, you know, the bright orange pop-up. So if there's any wary fish, they'll avoid that pop-up and eat this hook instead, and hopefully catching me them too. Well, we're into a carp. I'm so pleased I've caught one. It's absolutely freezing here now, and the fish just aren't really willing to feed on the bottom at the moment with the way the weather is. So I've just chucked a zig rig out, and they've rattled off. Happy days. Yes. Well, where there's one, there's two. Just landed that fish in the net, and literally the other rod's gone straight away. And we're into another one. I mean, on these big gravel pits this time of year, these fish, they really do shoal up. And obviously the fish have just moved over the sort of the area where I'm fishing, and they can't help themselves, but if they see a bit of food, they will eat it. It wouldn't surprise me if we do catch one off the bottom now. Oh, that's a nice mirror carp.
Yes!
Lovely. Happy days. Two in the net, two at once. Madness. Nice mirror carp, probably around 16 pounds. Pleased to just put one on the bank, really. It's freezing cold now. We've had to change to the conditions slightly. But yeah, well chuffed for this. So I'm gonna slip this one back. We'll have a look at the other fish. You can go and tell all your big mates we're here. Here's the second fish. Real nice mirror carp again. Slightly bigger than the last one. I'm not really bothered how big they are, to be honest, in this weather. A bite is the main thing, and just happy to put a fish on the bank. Really pleased. I'm gonna pop this one back, see if we can get another bite. Well, we're into another fish. Really thought that was it for the day. Nice little surprise towards the end of the session. Bagging another one. Feels like a good fish, this one as well. Come on, you beauty. It was really heavy, this fish.
Yeah. Nice. Lovely. Well, chuff for that one. Turned out to be a really good day. What a nice way to finish the day off. To be honest, I didn't think I was going to get another bite. And then this little fella come along, topped it off nicely. Wonderful.
They're solid, those brazenose fish, aren't they? Big, thick, wide things.
Yeah, they don't look much, but they really pack in some muscle, to be fair.
When the crew said, oh, we're out filming with Mark this week, I thought, going to be a bit of a struggle, because it had been really cold, and the wind was wrong, and really high pressure. And I just wonder if that's the reason why you caught on zigs, that they were coming over to investigate the feed, but because high pressure impacts on fish much more, it doesn't us, and it affects their swim bladder. Well, I'm not that concerned about, oh, look, there's something there, and they've just eaten your zig because it's in front of them.
Yeah, I mean, when they're not feeding, they're just picking those zigs up out of sort of curiosity.
Yeah.
And when, it, you know, it's great when they're feeding, you can fish them properly on the bottom, and it's happy days, how you want to fish. But if they're not feeding, if you don't sort of move with the conditions, you're just not going to catch.
Exactly, yeah. Welcome back, Mark Bartlett is with me in the body this week, and as Mark will tell you, we're talking carp, because really, that's just about the only species you're interested in, isn't it?
Yeah, pretty much. I have an odd little dabble for a few roach, some bream, skimmers, but mainly carp.
Yeah, but on all kinds. You're a big carp angler, you're a competitive carp angler, and you're a match angler that catches carp in normal pole matches or pellet waggler matches or whatever. Yeah, you do the lot, don't you?
A carp freak.
Carp freak, that's a pretty good description. But the remarkable thing about the film we saw in part one was the zig rigs and the action that you got over what amounts to, for this time of the year, a big bed of bait. And you said, tell us again the reason why you think they were over it.
But the noise, you know, it's no different to going pole fishing for roach. You ball in with some balls of ground bait, you know, the roach comes straight in. With the carp, carp are the nosiest creatures in the water, aren't they? Any noise, they're like, oh, what's going on? So by putting the bait out there, and these lakes nowadays, they've got big heads of fish as well. So when they come over you, you've got to sort of keep them in your peg as well. And by using real bright visual baits, you can do that. And if they don't want to feed, all they're going to do is just sit above it.
Yeah, to make sure nothing else takes it, basically. Almost a dog in a manger attitude. Now, I'm going to get the old tank up here because we've made the world's smallest zig rig. It is literally, it's a micro zig, but I think it describes perfectly, it shows perfectly exactly how they work. Now this is your zig rig, which is a bit of lead core.
Yep.
You've got your lead clip, as you would in a normal way, on there. A little bit of anti-tangle tube. You'd normally have a longer boom than that, I would think, wouldn't you?
For the zigs, yeah. But that is an anti-tangle sleeve for just a bottom bait rig.
So now I'm going to drop it in the water, and you've got to use a little bit of imagination here. Instead of that being like 4 centimetres from the bomb, imagine it being 2 metres or maybe more away from the bomb. But that's exactly how it sits up in the water. It sits like that. It looks like a hook with something on it. It doesn't look like a bit of bait that's also got a hook on it. It looks like a hook with something attached. But fish don't know they're hooks, do they?
No, there's a little bit of method in the madness. Obviously, with the amount of maggots that the carp lakes see in the winter, I've chosen for a red one. In the summer, I'd probably have a yellow one.
That's a zig aligner, isn't it? That's a very clever piece of kit that actually makes the hook sit at a good angle and holds your whatever lure you're using as a zig, and that's just a piece of black foam, I take it.
Yeah, they're real hassle-free. You just tie your hook on, feed one of them on, and put whatever colour foam you want in. But the beauty about the zig is that you can fish them at any depth in the water. And some of these lakes, you know, especially big gravel pits, they can be up to 20 feet deep. And like I said on the film, if the fish are just sat there doing nothing, you know, I'd rather present my hook in front of the fish rather than 10 feet below them. So zig gives you that opportunity.
When you were fishing 3 rods at Brazenose there, did you have zigs on all 3?
Yeah, I did.
And were they at varying depths?
Yeah, the day before I caught a couple on zigs as well, and they were at 5 foot. But as the weather
5 foot down or 5 foot up?
Oh, 5 foot up from the bottom.
Right.
In 14 foot of water.
So 8-9 foot.
Yeah.
I've got to see. I'm reason for asking you that. Yeah, go on.
And then the next day, couldn't get a bite on that, and we chucked a 9 and a 10 foot out, and you know that's what we caught the bites on.
See, I've got this theory that in absolutely equal barometric pressure, when it's on that medium, when it's not low and it's not high, about that's 1,000 millibars or whatever it is, when it's there, fish like to be 8 feet down. Obviously, some lakes aren't that deep, but when lakes are that deep, 8 foot seems to be their equal pressure, if you like, when they used to have to use less impact on their swim bladder than at any other time. When the pressure's lower than that, they will sit lower in the water. When the pressure's higher, they'll sit higher, because high pressure actually pushes down on lakes and must make them more uncomfortable to go deeper. So look for fish in shallow water when it's high pressure or higher up in the water. And I'll bet if you'd have had your little barometer, or if you'd have tapped your phone and your barometer had come up, pressure would have gone up, which is why they were higher in the water. That's a theory that I've had for a long time, and it definitely pays off for me anyway.
It did. On the second day, it did go up. I did check, and that's obviously concludes your theory.
Yeah. Now, if you could have caught on the bottom, if we'd have been there, stayed there longer, and you'd have caught on the bottom, you'd have used sort of basic pop-up rigs, wouldn't you? I'm going to drop this one in. This is a normal pop-up. It's a piece of coated braid. Is it coated? Yeah. You stripped off the last little bit. Just see that nice hinge there. You've got a match angler split shot on there.
Yeah, they're really handy there.
that's just a piece of tubing sleeve to cover the eye, is it?
Yeah, it just gives it, sort of kicks it over a bit like a little
I'm
claw.
I'm just going to drop that in there. There you go. And you see how slowly that sunk to the bottom, and that now sits up perfectly. Now, if a fish is coming from above, and we haven't got a camera up there, so you can't see, but if that was coming from above, all it can see really is the bait, everything else underneath. And it'll pick it up, and is that rig designed to turn around into its bottom jaw?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the way it sinks really slowly is, so if the fish does pick it up, and in the winter, the fish are cold, they want to use as little effort as possible.
Yeah.
So that's going to, you know, slip up inside the fish's mouth real nice and easy, and with the way the hook's curved over, whenever it shuts its mouth or it moves off, that's going to come down onto the bottom lip, you know, which is the best place to hook the fish.
And they then feel resistance, and as soon as they feel resistance, they shake their head, and that if the hook's sharp enough, it goes in. If it's not sharp enough, it comes out. So it's one of the things why you want hooks as sharp as possible, isn't it? And this is, it's a similar rig, it's slightly different. This has got plastic corner, and I'm going to drop that in there, which should be about in the middle. Oh, that's, so I've tangled that up as I've dropped it in, sorry. Let's get it out and do it again. That's it, there we go. Oh, no, it's sitting like, let's sit in the other way around. Should that be sitting like that?
To be honest, it doesn't really matter how it
okay.
sits. That little bit of corn is just sort of almost taking the weight of the hook.
Yeah.
I've actually taken that red sleeve off of a zigger liner, and that's just to look like a maggot. Because obviously we're feeding sweet corn and maggots and the odd boilies, so we've got a boilie which is brighter than the feed boilies to catch their attention, and you know, the maggot and the sweet corn to catch the wary fish.
Yeah. do you think at this time of the year, and I don't want to talk about flavours and baits and everything now, I want to save that for a little bit later on. When we talk about fish at this time of the year, do you think they're more attracted to colour rather than taste in the sort of the way that you're speaking about them now, in this conception we've got of fish, this time of the year looking, they're attracted more to the colour than the flavour of the bait?
Yeah, definitely. I think in the cold, the colours are better, just because I think the flavours don't work as well in the winter. You know, it's like pellets are brilliant, but in the winter they're not very effective because they can't release their flavour.
Yeah.
So that way it's... And also, these fish that are in these big gravel pits, a lot of them are new fish.
Yeah.
So that is like, they're nice and bright, like little... Sort of catching a kid in a sweet shop.
You've got
that nice little fancy sweet's always going to...
It just catches their eye, yeah. Now, we've got some pictures of fish you've caught. The first one, and this is going away from a bit from the multiple catches that you're most known for, but I did say right at the start, you're also a catcher of very big fish, and you have target fish, and this, I think, is one of them.
This is a dream fish for me. Mm. I've watched this fish grow up from sort of mid-20 pounds to just under 48 pounds, that one.
Wow.
So, yeah, it's a real corker.
Is that a linear fish?
Yeah, it's out of St John's.
Oh, St John's. I've only fished St John's once and it was piking. I went and caught some pike, lots of pike in the lake. And there were carp anglers there that day. That was in the winter, obviously. But that is a corking fish. You said you'd seen it a few times.
Yeah, I've just, over the years, seen it on the bank and watched it grow up. And that's where I grew up fishing from 15 years. There's actually a sister fish to that called the Big Common. And that was my first ever fish from St John's. Really? And that's the similar weight. And so it's nice now I've sort of paired them together.
Yeah. Now, that's a big fish, but as Crocodile Dundee would have said, no, that's a big fish. That's an absolute huge thing. That's like a hippopotamus.
Yeah, that is a proper fish.
Is that, that's not an English fish, though, is it?
No, that's from France. It's 75 pounds there.
75 pounds. I would struggle to hold that up. Yes. That's such a huge fish. And whilst it looks big there, I mean, this is the picture that makes it for me. That looks big, doesn't it? That looks big. I mean, look at the size of that thing from side on. That's like a person. I mean, that is a massive... The size of its mouth.
Yeah, that picture puts it in perspective. The other picture's nice to see the fish, but that one really shows the sort of...
I mean, you're a bit of a unit. You're not a skinny little weed, are you? You're a bit of a unit. And that's a big fish. And what sort of tactics did you use to catch that?
Exactly the same. The principles are the same. I went there for one trip, and the weather was sort of not good for fish feeding on the bottom, and that's a lake that's 20 feet deep. So the start of the week, I caught a few on zigs, including some fish up to 59 pound.
Zigs.
Yeah. And then when the weather changed, straight away it kicked off on the bottom then, and caught, I think it was another 850s on the bottom.
God.
So, and yeah, 75, 260 pound commons.
Ah, oh, it's not bad, is it?
No.
As Mark proves, it's not only possible to catch target carp, but to catch them too. And for most fisheries, the important thing's feeding times. There's always a spell when bites are more likely, and if you can identify that time, it's a real help. And do you find that just by asking around or by your experience?
Experience and asking around. You know, if there's guys there fishing, then, of course, go and speak to them. Their eyes on the water, and this time of year, location is key. And if you can get on the fish, then I'd fancy a chance of a bite or two.
And we spoke about this before we came into the bothy, and carp generally hole up this time of the year. Usually, in my experience, they'll be as far away from the bank as they can get in the middle of the lake. But sometimes it's exactly the opposite.
Yeah, you know, they could be in the bank underneath the cover, especially on the smaller waters. I'd be looking there and just a few little telltale signs and spend a bit more effort on location and...
What do you do to locate fish? Because, I mean, so many fisheries these days, I know there's a bit more room in the winter, but sometimes you go even to a normal carp water and you have to draw a peg or nominate where you're going to fish. So how do you find the fish? What's your clues?
Generally, like the fish, they'll all be together. So if you've just any information of any fish being caught, I'd have a look there. If you can see them jumping, especially on the big gravel pits that I fish, you know, that's the one when they're showing, you know, yeah.
if they stick their heads out, they've got to be there, haven't they?
That's a big giveaway.
Now, we mentioned zigs and the importance of fishing the layers, but you're also a very, very keen bait angler. You use a lot of bait. How do your winter baits vary from your summer baits?
Just slightly more digestible, really. You know, with the maggots and the sweet corn, that can pass through the fish. They can sort of feed on that very easily, not like chewing a big boilie. And then fishing little bright bits over the top just to pick their attention out.
You still fish a few boilies, though, don't you? Feed a few boilies, but I notice you soaked them in that sweet corn water. That's got two things. First of all, sweet corn water is usually salty and sugary, so it's got two big attractors there. But you also said it softens the baits up. Is that a deliberate ploy?
Yeah, especially this time of year. You know, I want those fish just to, if they are going to feed, it's just be nice and easy for them. Mm. So by soaking the boilies, a little effort, and that just break down in their mouth, you know, as they're feeding on it. And it's easier for the fish as well. It gives them some food for this time of year.
There's a couple of examples of your high-vis baits here. I mean, of course, they're a really visible bait. You mentioned how bright sweet corn is. They're really almost fluorescent, and they've got quite a strong smell to them as well.
Yeah, I can smell them from here. And,
nice smell.
Yeah, that is what you want. You just want something just to grab the fish's attention. Even in the smaller waters where, they're not so clear as the gravel pits, that's going to stand out further again. Maybe try a white one.
The great thing with winter baits is they generally smell nice. Summer baits generally smell horrible, don't they? With more fish meals and stuff like that. But these smell really attractive, and these are all pop-ups, are they?
They are, yeah, yeah.
And would you fish them on their owner's pop-ups, or do you ever fish a snowman rig with a bottom bait underneath?
I just almost match the size of my free offerings. So whatever I'm feeding, I'll match my hook bait to suit.
Now, I did have a little dig in your bag as well, though you were looking, and I came up with this. Now, I'm always wary of unmarked bottles. Dare I open this and smell it?
Yeah, be my guest. This a real nice, sweet flavouring.
Well, that just smells... I couldn't say what it smells of, but it smells sweet. I mean, it's slightly fruity, a little bit of... It smells like those old-fashioned fruit drops, almost, but it really is sweet.
It's got, like, a real sticky texture to it as well, so when you... I use it just for dunking my zigs in before I cast out in the lake.
Oh, yeah.
So the stickiness of it actually stays on the hook bait, so it don't come off when you cast, like most flavourings.
Do you think that flavouring zigs is important? I mean, they are primarily a target bait, aren't they? There's something there, they can see it in the water, and they'll take it. Do you think they'll take it before they taste it, or do you think that does put, like, a little... aura of attraction, I used to call it, with ground bait, a little haze of taste around it?
I think it's just a little bit of everything, and this time of year it's about percentages, and if you break all those percentages down, you know, every little sort of extra just helps, and it certainly doesn't do me any harm.
It doesn't, does it? It also, I think it's a little bit of a confidence factor for us as well. If you can make something smell nice, you know, baits, I mentioned summer baits smell horrible, winter baits smell lovely. They've got to smell one or the other. It's so good. Oh, yeah, that smells all right. They've got to be quite distinctive, haven't they, for our satisfaction and our confidence. Yeah.
I mean, if I was a carp, I know that I'd be a sucker for that one.
Yeah.
So, yeah, definitely.
That would be the equivalent of a nice chocolate biscuit or something like that. Yeah. It is a lovely smell. Well, all something to look forward to the weekend. Don't forget your flavours. Don't forget your bright baits. Don't forget to put some feed in, but don't necessarily expect to catch them on the bottom. That's it for this week. Remember to keep those Young Angler of the Month photos coming in on email, together with details about you and the catch, as well as some parental consent. You can find all the terms and conditions on our website, alongside films from the show and loads of other information. And you can also follow us on Twitter, of course. Been great chatting to you, Mark. Thanks so much for coming in, mate. Always enjoy our chats. Now, next week, my good mate Dave Lewis will be here with me, one of the most travelled and best experienced sea anglers on the scene. He's always got some top advice. Join us at 6 o'clock on Sky Sports 3. That's next Friday, 6 p.m. on Sky Sports 3. We're also available on demand every week. Find us in the Sky Sports section of Catch Up. We've also put a few more little collections on there, so go and check those out. But have a great week, wherever you're fishing, and tight lines. Thanks, mate.
Well done.
Enjoy Sky Sports Live. On all screens, on the go, and the best bits on demand.